talking about your background more seriously, maybe because, to be honest, for me it is a term that I have never heard about, incubation engineer. What is it about?
So the incubation department at GitLab, there's a few more incubation engineers, is a group of people that try to explore either new features or try to incubate new features or new markets into GitLab. We're all engineers, so we are supposed to deliver code to the code base. We are supposed to find a group or a new persona that we want to bring into GitLab, talk to them, see what they want, bring in new features into GitLab and explore if they want, if that those features do make sense in GitLab or not. So it's a little bit of like very early development of new features, and that's why the term incubation. So our engineers that are really more focused into putting the 0 to 80 rather than and then eventually that 0 to 80 will be passed into a regular team, which will do, if it makes sense, we'll do the 80 to 95 or 80 to 100.
So now you're kind of a single person in the team, right? Building out the MLOps capabilities.
Yes.
Can you give us a glimpse into your maybe day to day? How do you manage to do all of it?
So GitLab is great because I don't have a lot of meetings, at least not internally. And so I spend most of my day actually coding. Most of it is actually implementing features and then getting in contact with customers, either by direct contact with scheduling calls with them or by reaching out to the community on Slacks and LinkedIn and or physical meetups, to talk to them what they want, what they need, what are the requirements. One of the challenges is that it's not a customer, like the people that I have to think about are not the users of GitLab, but are the people that don't use GitLab. Those are the ones that I'm building for. Those are the ones that I put in new features for, because the ones that are already at GitLab, they already use GitLab. The incubation is more how to bring new markets, new people into the ecosystem of GitLab, into the platform. So it's if I rely only on the customers we already have, that's not enough. I need to go out and look at users that want to use or maybe have it available but don't have reasons to use it.
But when it comes to, let's say, new capabilities that you are building, you mentioned that you are communicating with customers, right? So mm-hmm. I would guess these are organizations that are doing regular software, but would like to also use GitLab for machine learning, or are you straightly targeting some customers that are not yet GitLab customers, right? So users, probable users, let's call them.
Yes, both of them. Of course, the easiest one is that the customers that already have, that already are on GitLab and they have a data science group within on that company, but that data science group doesn't find good reasons to use GitLab for. So I can approach them and see, and that it makes it easier because they can start using right away. But also brand new users that never had, that were more data science users with more data science heavy workflow that want to, I'm trying to find a way to set their DevOps, their MLOps cycle. And yeah, GitLab can be an option for them.
And was it easy to narrow down to the capabilities that you're going to build next? Looking from the very beginning, let's say, when you started.
So in DevOps, you have decided DevOps lifecycle. And I'm more looking right now at the devs part. So right up until a model is deployed, is ready for deployment. So I've started with code review. I implemented Jupyter Notebook diffs and code review for Jupyter Notebooks a while ago. Then model experiments. This has been released recently. And now I'm implementing model registry. I started working on the model registry within the GitLab. So more on this, the first cycle, the ops. Once you have the model registry and once you have model registry, the ops, there are some things that you can add, but right now that's the main. So observability you can add later once you have the registry. So that's more part of the ops. But on the dev, this is what I've been looking at. Code reviews, model experiments, model registry, hopefully pipelines eventually.
Uh-huh. And these requests came straight from the users, I guess. It's not something.
It depends. It depends. I was a machine learning engineer before. I added a scientist. So a lot of what I do is personal pain. And I bring a lot of my past experience into looking at what could be, because I was a GitLab user before as a data scientist, both as an engineer and as a data scientist. So I could see what could be done with GitLab, but I couldn't because the tooling was not really there. And so I bring that. I talk a lot of customers. So MLflow or the model experiments was a feature that was suggested by customers in the past. Model registry as well. So it's there are a lot of things to be done. And it's hard to choose what to look for. And at that point is usually what I'm most excited about. Because if I'm excited about something, I can build faster. And then I can build more.
And I have a question more on the organizational level. It is something that I've read at GitLab handbook. For those who don't know what it is a kind of open source public wiki or set of documents that describes how GitLab is organized. And you can, like, for me, this is a great inspiration of for how to structure different stuff from HR, engineering, product at the company, at the software company. And there was a paragraph about how we are starting new things, like MLOps support or MLOps, GitLab offering for MLOps community. And you're an example like of this policy that they are starting from a, like, on one hand, they are starting lean. So you're one man show, right? But they put the super senior guy in charge of it. That I found not like, it sounds for me like a smart thing to do. But surprisingly, and I think that I've done this mistake in the past where I wanted to start something new. I wanted to start lean, so or rather put more a junior level person in charge because it is about being lean, right? But it was not necessarily successful because you need to, this problem is not defined. So my question is, how would, because you said, yes, you're also an engineer, what are the hats you're effectively wearing to run this? Because it sounds like interdisciplinary.
Yeah. Yeah. So there are many ways of kickstarting a new initiative within a company. Starting lean or incubation engineers are more for the risky stuff. So things that we don't really know if it makes sense or not, or they are more likelihood to not make sense than to make sense. For other cases, we can, like, every team that we have, every team that is on incubation can also kickstart their own initiatives. They have their own process or of how to approach. They have more people. They have UX support. They have a lot of different ways. Our way is we have an idea, we build it, we ship it, we test it with users. And for that, the hats that I usually have to wear is mostly the like backend front-end engineer to deploy the features that I need, product manager to talk to customers, to enter the process of deploying things at GitLab, of understanding release cycle, how to manage everything around, how to manage process with other teams. A little bit of UX, but I prefer to delegate UX to actual UX researchers and UX designers. But the early version, I usually build instead of like asking a UX to or a designer to create a design. I build something and ask them to improve it. So that's more of the path that I've been.
You also have this design system, right? Pyjamas. I'm not sure what was the name.
Yes, pyjamas. They do. It does help a lot. At least you get the blocks going, the blocks moving. But still, from the blocks to something that it's better within GitLab. You can still build something bad even if you have blocks. So the UX, I usually ask UX once there's something aligned or something more tangible that I can look at. And then at this point, we already can ship to users as well. So they can have, so the UX has feedback from users directly. So it's a bit of all, and then the data scientist, most not really at delivering things, but when I chat with customers, it's really helpful that I was a data scientist, that I was a machine learning engineer, because then I can talk in a more technical term with them, on more direct terms. Sometimes, like the users are, they want to talk technical, they don't want to talk on a higher level, they want to get down to it. So that's very helpful. But on the day-to-day, that the head of data science and machine learning is more for the conversations and for what needs to be done rather for what I do right now.
Who would be the next person you would invite to your team to support you? Like if you can choose, what would be the position?
Right now, I think it would be a UX to bring in, and then more engineers, I think. That's how it would grow this a bit more.
I'm asking this question because I think that what you do is a kind of extreme hardcore version of a ML platform team, where ML platform team in an organization is supposed to serve data science ML teams within the organization, but you have a broader spectrum teams to serve. So that's why I'm asking.